which is also an inconvenience. So you have to kind of decide which one, to close the street and have people park down the road, or take a chance, open the street up and allow them to drive with the possibility of just charging their car. This is a very common complaint. It's inconvenient and it's nasty and nobody likes it, but it is kind of inherent in the street building business. Interruption in mail service. I heard a rumor that they may not have delivered the mail. I don't know this for a fact, but in the contract documents, the contractor is required to keep those streets open at all times, and he is required to maintain the way for the U.S. Postal Service to deliver mail. And to my knowledge, he has done that. If mail did not get delivered, it was because they decided not to. And if that occurs, I believe people can go to the post office and get their mail. But again, it's a contractual requirement that he keep the roads open and maintain that service. This third item here, the scraping debris, is part of his prep work. He'll take a blade and he'll clean off the edge so he has a nice clean edge that he can pave on. And those, the clippings of the debris get shoved to the side. And we've had some complaints about people who, you know, it's been piling up and people are trying to mow their lawns and what have you. He will clean this up before he leaves the project. It's part of his cleanup and contract requirements. Unfortunately, it's been there for a while and it's become an inconvenience. And I think that the next program we'll clean up that language too and have him clean up within a certain period of time on every street. Other citizens' concern, there were some people that were very worried that the street was going to be rebuilt higher outside of the house, and they were worried that it would block drainage. I think this is pretty much a perception issue. In the contract documents, we're very explicit with the contractor that he is to remove 8 inches of material and to come back with 8 inches of material in the same location, horizontally and vertically, of the existing street. And if he feels like he needs to go out and do survey, take elevations to make that happen. I think what happens when the initial excavation takes place and the new base material comes in and it's not compacted, people get a little worried because they see it all mounded up and they think that it's going to go in too high. But as you can see on the right, as he paves and he compacts, you'll notice the street is kind of going back in exactly where it was. So the goal and objective is to put that street right back where it was, and it will drain pretty much as it did before. And if there's a problem, it'll still be there when he's finished. And we talked about the extraneous pavement. On the photo on the right, I had a tough time because the subject was too far away, but on the left of the street, you see in the right-hand photo, there's a strip of pavement and then there's a curb. And that strip of pavement is in pretty good shape, so is the curb. And that's one of those areas where Alex, on a daily basis, will look at that and decide whether it needs to be chip sealed or not. So that's a call he will make. And that's just a really good example of that extraneous pavement. This only lasts for a couple of hundred feet. You know, there's nothing, and all of a sudden you've got a couple hundred feet of this pavement and curb, and then you've got nothing after it. So. Project costs, the contract amount is around $670,000. There is a possibility that there will be some change orders on here. We found some unknown utilities on C Street. I can't remember if we found some on A Street or not. There may be some change orders associated with that. And then also the contractor inadvertently paved more than what was called for on Goliad. We may see a change order on that, we may not. But at this point, there are no change order requests. So.
What do you mean, unidentified utility?
On C Street, there were two or three sewer cleanouts that existed below the pavement that nobody knew about. So when the contractor went in there and excavated out 8 inches of material, he basically tore off the tops of those cleanouts. And so they have to be repaired. There was a, there was also a manhole that was damaged during his excavation process. And we're gonna have to work out who pays for that. He may have to pay for that. The city may have, we should have worked that out. But if he encounters an unknown utility and he has to fix it or it causes him delay, whatever, he has the right to request additional money.
But that's a known utility. If the manhole was a known utility.
If you can see the meter box there and he damaged it, then he's gonna be responsible for fixing it. But if you can't see it, nobody knows it's there, then, but I think the city has basically gone in and done most of the repair work. So if there is a change order, you know, related to the utility adjustment, it's gonna be pretty small.
Thank you.
That wasn't so bad.
But our cap is $750,000, right?
The contract is $670,000. Do you know what the contingency authorization was, 10%?
15.
15?
15.
So probably another $100,000 would be your contingency. You're gonna be well with it.
Lower than 70.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Next, were you through?
I'm through.
On this one, okay. All right, the water project.
Yes, ma'am. You have the schedule?
Oh, I've got it.
All right, Henrietta asked me to come and give you an update on where we were, where we are with the USDA-funded water system improvements. We were given a notice to proceed a couple of weeks ago, and we are obviously working on the job. We've had several internal planning meetings internal to M&S. That's very normal for us, where we plan out the work, make sure we have the resources scheduled, make sure everybody's on the same page. So we're internally kind of kicking all this work off. We have a kickoff meeting with the city next Thursday, I believe.
Yeah.
And Henrietta will be there along with David and the water folks, so that everybody's kind of on the same page as to what we're doing. So it's a lot of startup activities. We probably haven't accomplished much, but we are definitely off and running. I thought I'd spend just a few minutes giving you a sense of how the work will progress over the next couple of years. The work is divided into fundamentally five different construction packages. Construction package number one is a new ground storage tank at Plaza to include the reconstruction of the aerators that exist there at all the plants. And then we're going to establish standby power. And that standby power includes a new mobile generator set that you can, it's truck mounted or trailer mounted, so that you can move that generator to any one of your water plant sites and your lift stations in case the power goes out. And that work also includes the electrical connection refits that we've got to do at each location, so that when that trailer pulls up, you can just plug it in and start up and go. That'll be the first package that we sent to bid and into construction. The second package is the rehabilitation of your wells at Hospital and B Street. The third construction package is the automatic meter reading system, where we'll replace every meter in the system with an automatic meter reader, so your crews can drive down the road with a laptop and easily read all the meters, collect that data, and then dump it into your billing system.
if I'm reading correctly, that would happen in October of this year?
Yeah, month number one is March.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so September-ish.
September-ish. Now, do we have the software to match up with that meter reading?
That comes with the meter itself.
Oh, that comes,
we'll upgrade that.
Oh, that comes with that whole package?
Yeah, it'll include meters, all the equipment, computer equipment needed to read them, software upgrades, and training.
And it does, yes, and it integrates with our current program, our Encode, our current utility billing program, Encode. It interacts with that, so they can literally go out the field, read it, come in, and just download it directly into it. So it will eliminate all human error.
The fourth construction package is the replacement of water mains, generally in the downtown area. And that package also includes the installation of some valves that will create a third pressure plane in the water system. And then the last package there is the ADA improvements to this structure here, the City Hall. As you can see, how it kind of progresses, we're required to get all of the projects bid by December 7th of this year. So we gotta hustle. The whole program is about a year and a half, maybe a little longer than a year and a half. So it'll go into probably towards the end of next year.
Did you say everything had to be bid by December?
That is our commitment to you as BS, that's correct.
And according to this timeline, you've got months 11 and 12 bidding phase 4 and 11 and 12 bidding phase 5. If April is month 1, that's into 2017.
I'll have that corrected. But the goal is to get everything bid.
Because you would have to back that up 4 months almost. And that would probably also back up the design and the design phase as well.
Yeah. Any other questions?
No,
okay.
Thank you.
Good work.
Good job.
Thank you.
We're through with all the presentations. Next, item number 3, new business. A, CNA to approve the voluntary integration for City of Pharmacy. Community Development Director.
Good evening, Mayor Smith-Westman. We have a request for CVS Pharmacy to do a voluntary annexation. It's on 4P&Z. They have recommended approval to council. And Chris Hugg has been working with them to make sure we get all their documents and paperwork in order.
So, Mayor,
2.3 acres.
Do we need any discussion? Any questions? Okay,
can I
have a motion?
Madam Mayor, I so move.
All right, can I have a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Citizen comments? Do we have any citizen comments on item 8? To approve the voluntary annexation for CVS Pharmacy. No comments. We'll go on to take a vote. All those in favor? Raise your right hand. Okay, all those opposed? All right, 3-0. Thank you. Motion carries. Item B, CNA to approve the permanent zoning of R1 Simple Family for the Lado G de Leon Event Center, property located on State Highway 97, Floresville, Texas, being 101.82 acres, tract 2790, SJ Arocha, survey abstract number one.
So move, Madam Mayor.
May I have a second?
Second.
Citizen comments? May I have a vote? All those in favor, raise your right hand. All those opposed? Two and three, motion carries. Item C, CNA to approve a request to rezone lots 1 and 2 of the Richardson subdivision from temporary R1, single family residential, to permanent C commercial located at 1531 US Highway 181 North Floresville, Texas. Any discussion needed on that one? Questions?
So move, Madam Mayor.
Pardon?
I so move.
I have a motion and I have a second.
I'll second, Madam.
Second. Citizen comments? No comments. May I have a vote? All those in favor? Raise your right hand. All those opposed?
3-0.
3-0. All right, motion carries. Item D, CNA to select an architect for ADA improvements pursuant to request for proposal dated February 18, 2016.
Mayor, actually, I think Tom has, this meeting was all about you today. In your packet, the city of Floresville for ADA is part of that water, as well as the city needs to do some additional work for life safety. Because M&S and I have agreed to hire the same architect so that we won't have two competing architects. We did receive and went out for proposals from the three companies listed there. M&S has rated them. We've met about them, and I agree with the recommendation. So they are recommending the Deborah Duckery architectural firm to be the architect that the city would hire was in this, if you approve. We do have a representative here from the company if you have any questions.
Mr. Turk, what is the scope of work for the entire project?
The scope of work will be developed, but right now on the city side, it's going to be some life safety issues that we have here in the city, as well as some cosmetic issues. And on M&S side, on the water side, it'll be the ADA accessibility.
Any other questions?
When you say cosmetic, what do you mean by cosmetic?
If you look at the exterior of the building, the siding actually has been dented and dinged, especially on this side. We also need to secure the building, so we need to take care of some issues because we're having bats and rats and mice in our building. We also need to rewire because those bats and mice are eating up our infrastructure as well.
Okay, so are we looking at a new type of facade for the building, or what do you envision?
Oh, what I envision is a new exterior sleeve for the building, definitely some reworking of our lobby area and our front desk area here. We need to have some new flooring, which have been noted as a tripping hazard, some painting and maybe some reconfigurations of some other items that we can look at. Definitely need to look at some type of key, so you know every time someone leaves, we have to give you one when you pass, so we're looking to do some more ID that we can use for not only getting into this building for security reasons, but also that we can use for people clocking in and clocking out.
Any other questions?
Mr. Towns?
Ceiling tiles, we look at the ceiling tiles, we look at the lighting, because some of these ballast fluorescent lights are antiquated and we're not able to replace them. That would be more of the life safety issue and updating the building, not necessarily ADA. That's why we needed to run them together. Even where you're sitting, because it needs to be handicap accessible, so we have elected official, they need to get to the dais, you need to address that issue.
That's not moved, Madam Mayor.
Well, we need a recommendation.
Recommendation?
Yes, as Henrietta said, there was an RFQ that was issued by the city of Floresville. There were three responses, three respondents. I was asked to review each one of those against the evaluation criteria that was listed in the RFQ. three proposals side by side against the nine or ten major points in the criteria. Deborah Dockery Architects was clearly the most qualified of the respondents. And I have a recommendation letter. It is dated March 15th. Deborah Dockery scored 73 points out of 100. Burdett Consultants out of the Houston area scored 48, and 1718 Partners scored 40 out of the possible 100.
And that letter recommendation is in your package.
Did you move on a motion, Mr. Ortiz?
I want to ask a question before we go to a motion. Tom, you and I discussed this, but could you explain a little bit of your how you scored?
Sure.
Is there a standard format for this, or how did we come about these numbers of 73, 48, and 40?
I don't know of any standard format that the city uses to evaluate proposals. So I basically created one that I thought was fair. I basically dissected the evaluation criteria, came up with 9 or 10 points to evaluate each proposal side by side. They were completeness. Did they provide everything that was requested in the RFQ? Their understanding of the project, did they understand what the scope of work was going to be? Did their proposal show a high level of interest in actually doing the work? Did the respondents' firms have similar experience compared to the type of work that had to be done? Did their staff have the qualifications, the certified education, and did they individually have the type of experience that would be needed on this work? It's essentially renovation projects, which I look for quite a bit. Did they bring forth and recommend a process, a visioning process, where they sit down with the city of Floresville and the building users and formulate a consensus on what needed to be done with the structure so that all the eventual improvements were going to match the needs of the user at the end of the day. The RFQ asked that there be local knowledge and then a list of any ethics violations, and then kind of a history of budget runs and the ability to finish projects with their budget. Those are 9 and 10 items. I did not weight those all the same. There are three or four in there that are more important than the others. Understanding of the project, many architects and engineers too will just submit a proposal, kind of a blind proposal, and not customize it. So I look for a true understanding, and Dockery's proposal excelled in that. They thought about what had to be done, and their firm experience and their staff qualifications matched along with their visioning process. Similar experience was very important. I look for renovation projects. From what I remember, Dockery listed 7 or 8 different renovation projects all in this area. The other two respondents might have had 1 or 2 each. So they clearly excelled there. Staff, all the proposers proposed very good staff. Dockery had more staff with actual renovation projects on their resume, so they scored better there. And they had a very good process from which how they would get from where we are today to, you know, through the visioning process and what exactly the scope of the work and the scope of the improvements were to be for the work. So at the end of the day, there were a very very clear selection. It was not a difficult selection for me, and it usually is.
The other point that you brought up in our discussion before the meeting is that of the proposals submitted, Dockery was very much local and as compared to maybe a firm out of Houston or Austin or something.
Yes, two of the firms were local, Dockery and 1718 Partners. Burdette is out of Houston. Clearly, they're not from here, so they would have a little difficulty getting up to speed on what is going on local and local codes and what have you. Plus, just from a basic responsiveness point of view, if you're from San Antonio, you can get here in a half hour. If you're from Houston, you cannot. Now 1718 Partners was kind of interesting. They are actually a design build organization. The RFQ did not request a design build organization. That didn't necessarily rule them out. At this point, I'm not thinking in that direction. So part of their qualifications, weren't considered because we weren't considering a firm's construction capability. So they didn't quite match what we were trying to accomplish.
Mr. Turk, do you have a list of companies or organizations that this group has been for or conducted renovation projects for?
Dockery? Yes, they have a statement of qualifications and they have 7 or 8 project descriptions that describe the renovation work that they did, who the client was, references, contact information.
Thank you, Tom.
You're welcome.
As far as I'm concerned, I don't know.
John,
Jackie?
Yes.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Turk. There was a half a motion.
Mayor, we bring him up.
You
want to
go back?
There's a representative here from the company, Ms. Dr. Nassau, if you'd like to ask her.
Yes, we met her earlier. Yes, thank you. Thank you for coming. Bye. So, would you like to refer your motion? I beg your pardon?
Rescind to it.
Okay.
I move to rescind my motion.
You rescind your motion, okay. May I have
I'll move that we go with the recommendations of M&S to select the architect firm of Deborah J. Dockery. This is for the ADA improvements at City Hall. Well, I guess within the city limits. Within the city organization, right? Is that what it is?
City Hall.
Yeah.
City Hall.
City building.
The City Hall.
Just City Hall?
City Hall, and there's a slight at the police department because they're back in the handicap department. Most of it's here at City Hall.
Okay, city facilities.
Thank you. We have a motion. May I have a second?
I'll second.
Citizen input? None? Okay. Take the vote. All those in favor? All those opposed? 3-0. Motion carries. Very good. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Next item, CNA to adopt a resolution for the City of Floresville's 3-year annexation plan for 2019.
Chris, can you speak to
a lot of discussion?
How much streets? I think we're going to ask Chris to talk about it. I think Councilor Ortiz's concern with the streets, if you can indicate how many streets, because there are not a lot of streets that we'll be adding on to this project. And so if you can address how much of the streets will be part of this project, because I think it's a small portion of this annexation.
Yeah, if you look at the areas that we're proposing, we're kind of trying to grab the fruit, if you will, so those properties which are contiguous within the amount of area that we had, at least 1,000 foot wide, et cetera, but really required us to do the least amount of infrastructure development. So in particular, all the areas in the end, the north annexation area, very small segment of what's now County Road 130 between Walmart and then extending over to Tipton Lane. That portion there. The only other area S1 has portions of Redbud, Eagle Nest, and Katie Lane. That area in S1 are the only areas that have residential style streets. Most of the areas on N and W and E are a
adjacent to the state highway system, so those, the maintenance of those doesn't, we don't start assuming maintenance of the state highway. Those remain with TxDOT, so we're simply taking in the area so that we have the ability to patrol them for police department activities, and also take on the adjacent property. So in terms of the total amount of streets, it's probably going to be less than 2,000 feet total of street that we would be assuming.
And can you speak to them that have city water right now currently?
Those that are, have city water currently, once they come inside the city limit, then they're going to be paying in city rates for their city water.
Which is half.
Which is half. We charge, actually, the council has approved to charge double if you're outside of the city limits. There's about six or seven homes, if you can imagine going down 97 towards the event center, there are about six or seven homes that are not part of us now that pay a double water bill, but we provide them with water. We also provide the small section going south, we provide them with water now. For those who do not have our sewer, they're currently on septic tanks already, and septic fields have been so since the inception. So the infrastructure is there already. We're just actually following along the land use plan that you all started back before I got here in 2010. I think you started, you approved it in 2014.
And Madam City Manager, Councilor, as we go forward with the three-year annexation plan and the next item on the agenda, which is talking about the ETJ agreement with the county. And as I read this agreement, without an annexation plan, we have no ETJ for permitting purposes, because all of this agreement authorizes the city for building permits, et cetera, to exclusively in that area identified in the city's three-year annexation. Not that I like that language, Mr. Hub, but the annexation plan, my point is that it's required for much more moving forward, and it's not tying the city's hands to say, we're absolutely going to annex it, but it's giving us the ability to do that in 3 years. But it also has to do with how does the city plan to grow, and that's a big part of this ETJ.
Correct. So the city does have some jurisdiction already under subdivision and things like that in the ETJ. And we'll get to it next, so I don't want to go too far on here, but the three-year annexation plan is to help guide growth with the county, try to develop kind of a mutual beneficial relationship with the county to kind of help Floresville and the area grow in a responsible manner, so we don't have like these cutouts. If somebody came in and they're not part of the city and they started a whole new development there and they built to whatever specifications they want to build to, if we did eventually annex it in 5, 10, 15 years, we're going to be taking care of streets that aren't built up to city code and have to strip them all out completely, or septic in residential areas where we want to have sewer and issues like that. So the two do tie in together. But this, for being just the purposes of annexation, we can go more in depth on that on the next item.
Mr. Hunt, why does it have to be voted on tonight? Earlier, it was said that we have to vote on it tonight because of legislature action. I don't understand that.
Every delay we take pushes it back that 3 years still. So if we don't vote on it tonight and we wait 6 months, it's 3 years from that date. And if we don't vote on it for a year, it's
right.
3 years from that
date. We have to wait 3 years. I mean, if we wait next week so we can look at it closer for revenues, for the cost involved, infrastructure that's needed, if it's needed, why does that be voted on right now tonight?
Well, part of the process that we're that I'm asking you to consider and vote on tonight is to say, okay, let's look at these areas. This makes sense. We know in terms of area, in terms of width, in terms of being contiguous. We got those criteria met. Part of the process is that we have an inventory prepared. We actually now, with your direction, would know, okay, I'm going to go into area E, and we're going to inventory the water facilities, the sewer facilities, the drainage facilities, the roads, part of that, so that we have that formal process to uncover those things and tally them up. And then it's at that point that we know what we're dealing with.
So you're telling me we don't know the inventory until we develop the resolution?
Well, we have a vague idea of what it is. We have a...
So we have a vague idea of the annexation.
And that's why the legislature gives 3 years on these. Because if you develop the whole plan and everything else, and you go into it right now, we're going to be delayed a year down the road trying to figure out all the minutia, and then it's another 3 years from there.
So if we don't vote on this today, and we wait till next month to vote on it, we're waiting a year?
No, if you wait till next month, you're waiting a month. But to try to assemble all of this, you can start the clock and do all that over the next year, and then you're running it concurrently. If you do it all before, then you're pushing the start date of that 3 year clock until you finish.
And Mr. Stewart, I think we've got a little disconnect here.
Okay.
The issue, and let me see if I understand this correctly, and I may be wrong. We're giving you a best case scenario or worst case scenario to say, here are the limits. Go, now you can go and figure out what it's going to cost us to annex that. You can give same projections for revenue. If we do this piece or we do that piece or we do all of the pieces. But until we give you a far left and a far right with a resolution, you can't start that process.
I'm just trying to be efficient with my time that you're paying me for. So I'm trying to come to you with what I think is the best hand of cards to play right now. And you say, okay, that's a good hand, now tally them up. And let's see if that really is the hand that we want to play. That's essentially where we're at.
And potentially all the cards. Here are all the cards that you could play. Mm-hmm. Oh, well, we determined, oh, well, it's not cost effective to do this card and this card, so we're going to delete them.
Exactly.
But we still have these cards
to play.
I'm
just putting a set of cards out there for you to choose.
Thank you.
I'd just like to make a motion that we table it. I'd like more specifics on the areas that we're considering, the potential revenue, the potential cost and infrastructure needs, public safety, everything involved. I think those are the things we need to consider before we take the resolution, not the other way around. Don't pass the resolution and then determine the cost.
Okay, if that's the way you want to proceed, then if you want to table it, it'll be another 6 to 9 months before we can come back to you to do that, so it no longer will be a 2019 plan, because we won't be able to compile all of that together and reference to do that, because it takes us that long. We were hoping that we could use the time going forward with your direction, but if that's the direction that the council wants to do, it'll be back to you in another 6 to 9 months.
Okay. Just earlier you said there was only 50 houses involved.
So you said you want to have population tax, ad valorem tax, potential sales tax to do that. That's going to take some time for us to calculate up. It's not just something that we do overnight. We need to bring you some hard numbers is what you're asking. We have we've done some preliminary projective numbers, but that's not something we want to bring to you that we're able to check and to review. So what we're saying is that we need to have a general idea, north, south. Are we going in the right direction? Are we annexing too much? Do you want to limit it? Is there something you want to remove? Because we need to know what the council is thinking. We've taken it to P&Z, if that's what you're thinking. If it's too much, you say, we don't want to do 30%, we only want to do 20%, then we'll back it up to 20%. But if you want to do the numbers, then we can pay the consultant and come back when we have all the solid numbers and we'll do all of the homework before. You do the plan, and then the clock will start ticking, and it'll be a plan of 2020 probably rather than 2019.
I have a motion to table. So we have more specific information. Do I have a second?
Second.
A motion motion and a second to table. Comments, citizen comments?
I'm going to make the comment, and I think this is, you know, for this council to direct staff to go down this road with a future growth plan, with PNC's work on this, Mr. Stewart's work on this, and not recognizing what the legislature has designed this three-year timeframe for. The process is to develop a plan, then develop the costs, then decide what are you going to do or not do, okay? But to back this up and do it the other way is I can't explain the action.
Thank you, Mr. Miller. Yes, sir.
Rob Erickson. In my humble opinion on this, from what I understand is I absolutely understand that there needs to be a master plan and acknowledge that you're concerned about the infrastructure. And both of these should be in parallel and in tandem with one another and should be forecasted. That I absolutely agree. So based upon the merits of what you're proposing, it seems to be that this council is considering it independent of other, the other factors. And oftentimes, myopia tends to seep in and you tend to overlook the strategic, or the forest from the trees kind of thing. I'm not saying that that has occurred. What I'm saying is that based upon the merits of what is being proposed, is being asked whether you want to have the flexibility to do so and create that in the future or not. And so it's all about flexibility that's available to this council and the city for growth. And I think that's the merits of the question is, do you want the flexibility or do you not? And I'm not really certain that I understand working conservatively towards something is always a prudent choice, but on its merits solely, it's a matter of what I see is just flexibility in the city to make sound decisions in the future and still have that choice ahead of you.
Sir, do you make decisions on a 10-minute presentation for the future of our city?
I do not. And I will tell you, personally that I everything that I've seen is this seems to be an independent element from a master plan that I've not heard from. And that's why I say, in my humble opinion, I don't know the background of this. What I will say is, in my humble opinion, from what I've seen, it's all based upon the ability to afford this council and this city flexibility to do something.
Thank you, sir. Your time is way over.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, I think the directive that we gave our city managers, including Ms. Turner, is that we want our city to grow. But so many times we've come to our meetings here and we've been told over and over that we need to fix our streets, we need to fix our infrastructure, our water, our sewer. Now we're getting all of that in place. Now, okay, let's keep on adding to the house. Well, let's take care of our things first. Let's take care of our things first. And I'm not saying put it away six to nine months. Let's look at what we have on the table, because we really don't have anything on the table. We have a map that's over there, and these are the things, but what is it? What are we really looking at? Go ahead.
Sorry, if I can interject, we're in citizen comment period right now. We've already got past the discussion.
I'd be happy to respond.
No, we only get a minute per citizen comment at this period per the charter.
Thank you.
I think we're all on the same page. I agree. Yeah. We're all on the same page.
Any other citizen comment?
I don't know that I'll say anything different.
Jim Long, Floresville. This plan, from the best I can tell, doesn't commit you to a single dollar for anything. It simply starts the ball rolling for the planning process for you then to later make a decision with all of the appropriate data that you need, cost data and everything else. I think you should approve this plan tonight so that things can move forward in parallel and not delay us in case we want to do things more quickly.
Jim, why couldn't we do that next week or next month?
Based on what the city manager said, to get the kind of data that you're looking for. Get the data that you're looking for.
Any other citizen comments? All right, we have a motion to table with a second on item E. All those in favor of tabling? All those opposed? 2-1. Motion carries.
Time's up there.
Thank you. All right, the next item. CNA to adopt interlocal agreement for regulation of development to the city of Floresville, extraterritorial jurisdiction with Wilson County.
And Mayor and Council, since this one is premised upon the annexation plan going to the county for review, I believe since the last one was tabled, this one should be tabled until such time as that one's approved as well.
So.
May I have a second to table?
Second.
Have a motion to table item F. All those in favor? I'm sorry, citizen comment. None? Okay. All those in favor? All those opposed?
2-1.
Motion carries to table. The last item, CNA to approve amended city of Floresville 2015-16 organizational chart.
Yes. What we have before you in your package, you have two. One that was done on September 14th, 2015, and the other one March 24th, 2016. One of the requirements for the USDA is to have an organizational chart. The organizational chart that we're focused on definitely, the only change that we have there is actually the USDA project accountant. We restructured it. As you see here, it's just the finance director, AP, report to the comptroller. The USDA project accountant will report to the comptroller. And then the front office supervisor and utility building clerks, we have two of them, will report to the USDA project accountant. Most of those collections that happen at the front are mostly with water and sewer, and so accounts and billing and those type of things. And so we restructured it. And so I'm recommending the change in the organizational chart so that we can provide that to the USDA as one of their requirements.
Tell me again what the change was.
The change is on the far right-hand side. Uh-huh. If you look at the USDA accountant, that position always reported to the comptroller. The change is that the front desk, the front office supervisor, and utility billing clerk report to the USDA project accountant and not to the comptroller.
And I believe that's because those funds, those funds are obligated to pay those back.
Yes. Most of their activity, 99% except for the recycling, actually deal with water and sewer.
Is that it? We have an action item on that?
Yes, sir.
Any questions?
Won't take any time. We've actually relocated that position, that personnel, to the front area, and a lot of the accounting and the collections are all part of the USDA. It's all water and sewer. And so as we make the transition, as we're talking about the meters that we're hoping to do, that we're going to do with the USDA, that transition would definitely be part of the water, and so she needs to be coordinating that effort.
So the USDA project employee still reports up to the comptroller?
Yes.
Has that change already been made?
Yes. But there was never a change in reference to who the USDA partner actually reported to. The only change is actually the front desk and the front counter was the only change.
Helen doesn't have any objection to this, correct? correct?
No.
On this one, does it show that the USDA project account reports to the finance slash AP?
No, she reports to the comptroller. You have to follow the line, it's direct account, and then the finance AP person reports to the comptroller as well.
That personnel has been changed out also, right? The finance?
Yes.
There's someone else in charge, I mean?
Yes.
Head of that?
But that position's the same. The position has been the same. It didn't change. Just the person.
Salary?
Just the person that fills it?
Yes.
Yes, is the same, but the salary is different. But there's no budget change. We just moved someone from one department to the other, so you're paying for that salary one way or the other. But in reference to the organizational chart itself, that position always reported to the comptroller, as did the USDA. The only change is that the front counter and the utility building are reporting now to the USDA.
Council, any discussion on that?
The USDA project account and the finance AP are at the same level of management?
No, sir, they are not. To approve the revised organizational chart.
Okay, I so move.
And a second. To approve the organizational chart. I have a motion. May I have a second?